Okay, so I'm Dr. Ratna Kumar, Associate Professor of Pediatrics. Okay, and this is my first theory class to you. The topic is acute diarrhea.
This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, this is the common condition we see in pediatrics, OPD. Okay, the commonest is, most commonest is respiratory problems. Then diarrhea. Parents bring the children to the pediatric OPD. Okay. The common one is fever with respiratory problems and diarrhea is the second. Okay. So you should be thorough in treating diarrhea cases. Right? So what is diarrhea? What is diarrhea? Definition of diarrhea.
Stools more than 3 times per day.
Passing more than 3 watery stools per day. Okay. Precisely, stool volume more than 10 grams per kilogram per day. 10 gram, more than 10 grams per kilogram per day in infants. And more than 200 grams per day in children over 3 years of age is called as diarrhea. More than 3 watery stools. That is number of quantity, more than 10 grams per kg per day in infants, more than 300 grams per day in children more than 3 years. Okay, so diarrhea is again classified as acute diarrhea, intermittent diarrhea, chronic diarrhea, persistent diarrhea, protracted diarrhea. Okay, like that. So what is acute diarrhea? Diarrhea lasting less than 7 days. The child is brought to the hospital with same problem, diarrhea, and more than 7 days, then we have to label it as intermittent diarrhea. Okay, diarrhea lasting 7 to 14 days. Chronic diarrhea is, if the diarrhea is persisting for more than 14 days and if it is non-infectious, it is called as chronic diarrhea. Okay, so acute is less than 7 days, intermittent is 7 to 14 days, chronic is more than 14 days but non-infectious. Okay. Persistent is again more than 14 days but infectious. Okay, protracted diarrhea, it may be infectious, it may be persistent, it may be non-infectious, that is chronic or persistent, that is more than 14 days with associated weight loss. Associated weight loss is there and diarrhea is there since 14 days, more than 14 days, then it is called as protracted diarrhea. Parenteral diarrhea, problem is not with the GI. Infection is somewhere else causing diarrhea. That is called as parental diarrhea. Okay. So what is the common cause of parental diarrhea? ASOMs. Acute suppurative otitis media. Child is brought to the hospital with ear pain and discharge. And at the same time there is diarrhea, then probably it is parental diarrhea. Or urinary tract infection can cause parental diarrhea. Or respiratory tract infections also can cause. So diarrhea is acute diarrhea, okay, intermittent diarrhea, chronic diarrhea, persistent diarrhea, protracted diarrhea, and parental diarrhea. Okay, so many types of diarrhea are there. And next one is dysentery. If it is mixed with blood and mucus, then it is called as dysentery. Passing blood and mucus in stools with or without fever and diarrhea is labeled as dysentery. Okay. During the first 4 months of life, number of motions are equal to the feet. Whenever the child takes feet, it passes two. That means they pass more than 3 stools in a day. But it is not diarrhea. It is called as gastrocolic. Something enters into the stomach, something is emptied from the colon. Okay? So that is called as gastrocolic. Don't label it as diarrhea. These cases should not be labeled as diarrhea, provided motions are golden yellow in color, non-mucoid, non-smelling, and child is not dehydrated, active, gaining weight then it is not diarrhea, it is gastrocolic reflux. Epidemiology. This is one of the major causes of infant morbidity and mortality. Diarrhea is one of the major causes of morbidity and mortality. Okay. The first cause of morbidity and mortality in children is respiratory disease. Second one is diarrhea. Average Indian child below 5 years of age gets at least 2 to 3 episodes of diarrhea per year. In a year, they suffer from 2 to 3 episodes of diarrhea in children less than 5 years. And mortality in India due to diarrhea is 6 to 8 lakhs per year. 6 to 8 lakh children, they die because of diarrhea. Okay. The incidence is more in children less than 5 years because they don't wash their hands, they keep everything in their mouth. Okay, if they are eating something, it falls down. They pick it up and again they keep it in the mouth and eat. Okay. So they don't know anything about hygiene. So that is the reason why it is more common in children less than 5 years. 80% mortality between 6 months to 2 years of age. In that age group, they don't know anything. Whatever is in the hand, they keep in the mouth. They touch everything and keep their fingers in the mouth. That is the cause of diarrhea. Sex, no predilection. There is no variation between a male child and a female child. The incidence is same. Peak incidence is seen in summer and rainy seasons. Risk factors for diarrhea, low socioeconomic status. Okay, low personal hygiene. Bottle or top feed. Only one bottle is there. Mother doesn't boil it every time. So they use the same bottle, okay, throughout the day without washing or without cleaning it. So they get infected. Then malnourished children, they are more prone for diarrhea. Early weaning and associated systemic infections could expose for diarrhea. Okay. What is the magnitude of problem in India? According to National Family Health Survey 2, okay, fever is the most common condition in children for which they bring a child to the hospital. 27% of children, okay, 27% of the OPDs, pediatric OPs, are fever cases. 17% are acute respiratory tract infections. 13% of pediatric OPD cases are diarrhea cases, and underweight 43%. Okay. What is the cause of etiology? It may be infectious, it may be non-infectious. Okay. Infections, among infections, viral diarrhea are more common. Okay. In viral, rotavirus is more. Luckily, now rotavirus vaccine is also available. Okay. Previously, it was not there. 3-4 years back, rotavirus vaccine was not there. Okay. So, viral, rotavirus, enteric adenovirus, Norvac virus, LC virus, astrovirus, coronavirus, and HIV. These are the viruses which cause diarrhea in China. Okay. Bacteria, E. coli. Okay, there are 5 types of E. coli are there. Shirisha coli. There are 5 types: enteropathogenic, enterotoxin, enteroinvasive, enterohemorrhagic, and enteroadhesive. Okay. Then Salmonella. Among bacteria, E. coli is the most common. Okay. In Salmonella, Shigella, Staphylococcus, Campylobacter pyogenes, Yersinia, Enterica, Politica. Then Aeromonas hydrophilia, Vibrio cholera, Clostridium difficile. These are the bacteria which can cause diarrhea, and among them, E. coli is the most common. Parasitic, Giardiasis, Amoebiasis, okay, Entamoebohistolytica. Then Cryptosporidium stromatolytica. Then food poisonings, ఉపాధ్యాయులు కదా ఒక్కొక్కసారి క్లాస్రూమ్ కర్ఫ్యూస్ బ్యాసిలస్ సిరీస్ ఇన్స్టాల్మెంట్ ఫంగల్ ఇన్ఫెక్షన్స్ క్యాండిడా ఓకే దెన్ సిస్టమిక్ ఇన్ఫెక్షన్స్ లైక్ పేరెంటల్ డయాబెటిస్ infection is not in the GIT infection somewhere else causing that is respiratory tract infections pneumonia urinary tract infections cystitis or ASOM kidney infection so these are the infectious causes of diarrhea non-infectious causes like food allergy food intolerance then anatomic defects malnutrition Cushing's disease, before microvillous atrophy, short bowel syndrome. Here, problem is not infectious because problem is with the anatomy of the GIT. Food poisoning, heavy metals and mushrooms can cause the diarrhea. Endocrinopathies like thyrotoxicosis, Addison's disease. Frequency is increased, but it is not because of infection. Malabsorption, disaccharidase deficiency, pancreatic insufficiency, CVR disease. Then neoplasms, malignancies like neuroblastoma, ganglioneuroma, Bollinger-Ellison syndrome. Okay, they can present as miscellaneous conditions like Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, laryngeal abuse. So these are all the non-infectious causes of diarrhea in pathogenesis, there are six mechanisms of diarrhea. One is osmotic, two is secretory, three is invasive, four is increased motility, five is decreased motility. So because of decreased motility, what happens? The bacteria which is there in the colon, it increases in number. They grow. That causes diarrhea. Decreased surface area. Okay? Due to villous destruction by water. So these are the six mechanisms. Cause all these are not needed for PGs, but this is when prepared for PGs, okay? So what, how osmotic diarrhea occurs? Osmotic diarrhea occurs after ingestion of a purely absorbed solutes. So what are those solutes? These solutes, they draw water from intestinal cells and cause diarrhea. Okay, solutes which are there in the intestines, they draw the water from the intestinal cells. So water enters into the lumen of the intestine from the intestinal cells. So they become dehydrated. A solute may be one that is normally not well absorbed, like magnesium, phosphate, or one that is not well absorbed because of the disorder of the small bowel. All of that carbohydrate is fermented in the colon and short-chain fatty acids are produced. So these short-chain fatty acids can be absorbed in the colon and used as an energy source. The net effect is increasing the osmotic flow. This form of diarrhea is usually lesser volume than secretory diarrhea. Secretory diarrhea, the water content is more in the stools. Osmotic diarrhea is not that much. It occurs if given carbohydrate soft drinks. Okay. ORS with high sugar. Okay. So they may develop hypernatremic dehydration. Okay. What are the features of osmosis? What are the features? What are the features of this osmotic diarrhea? Diarrhea stops once bleeding is stopped. Diarrhea stops after fasting for 24 hours. The pills are given, diarrhea continues. If nothing is given, then diarrhea stops also. The pH of the stool is always acidic. Okay. Stool is positive for reticulate substances. Then stool sodium is less than 50 milligrams per liter. These things are there, then we can suspect that it is osmotic diarrhea. Secretory diarrhea, then a second one. Secretory diarrhea occurs when the intestinal epithelial cells solute transport system is in active state of secretion. Okay. It is often caused by secretagogue, such as sclerotoxin, binding receptor on the surface epithelium of the bowel, and they phosphate stimulating intracellular accumulation of acyclic adenosine monophosphate, acyclic guanosine monophosphate. Secreted by the stool will be in large volume and persist even after fasting. Osmotic, once nothing is given orally, stool volume comes down. But secreted by the no. Okay. The stool osmolality is predominantly indicated with electrolytes. In osmotic diarrhea, it is less than 50 milliosmoles per kg. Now here it is 100 milliosmoles per kg. Okay. Then invasive diarrhea. Here, intestinal mucosal cells are invaded by bacteria. That is infection. Okay. Which causes inflammation. Okay. Then destruction of the epithelium, intestinal epithelium. There will be blood bleeding from the intestinal epithelium, which is seen in the stools, along with bleed blood, mucus also seen in the stool. That is in okay. Then motility disorders, hypermotility and hypermotility also causes diarrhea. Okay. Motility disorder can be associated with rapid or delayed transit in the okay. Slow motility can be associated with bacterial overgrowth. So it is not thrown out every day. Child passes school once in 2 or 3 days. Then what happens? There will be bacteria stay in the intestines itself, colon itself, the overgrow, and that can lead to diarrhea. Okay. The examples of secreted diarrhea is toxin induced. Example of osmotic diarrhea is lactose intolerance. Example of inflammatory diarrhea is Shigella. Okay. Motility diarrhea is Hirschsprung's disease or anorectal malformations. Among all these things, inflammation, okay, secreted and osmotic are more common. So, markers of secreted diarrhea. So, the child is brought to the hospital. Okay. With this problem, then we have to suspect that it could be secreted diarrhea. Child is brought to the hospital in condition of dehydration. Okay, electrolytes you have done, serum electrolytes you have sent to the laboratory, and there is dyselectrolyte. Potassium is low, sodium is more or normal or low. Then large stool volume, that is secret diarrhea. Okay, stool sodium more than 70 milliequivalents per liter, it is in favor of secret diarrhea. Stools are often alkaline, whereas osmotic it is acidic. Area stools are often alkaline. No effect with discontinuation of feeding. Osmolality equals to ionic constituents. Okay. Common example, commonest example for secreted area is cholera. The features of secreted area, they are dehydrated, there will be dyselectrolyte, abnormality in the electrolytes, large volume stools, stool. Discontinuation of the feeds doesn't reduce the stool volume. Okay, then stool sodium is more than 70 milliequivalents per liter, so that means sodium is lost more in the stool. Stools are often alkaline. Okay, so these are the features of secreted diarrhea. Whereas osmotic diarrhea markers, children are often stable. They are not dehydrated, they are stable. Stools are propulsive, plenty, large in volume. Watery or loose. And here stool sodium is less than 50 milliequivalents. Secreted diarrhea it is more than 70 milliequivalents. Whereas in osmotic diarrhea stool sodium is less than 50 milliequivalents. Stool osmolality is less than the ionic constituents. Whereas secreted diarrhea it is equal to ionic constituents. Osmotic diarrhea is less. Stools are acidic, whereas secreted diarrhea they are alkaline. Okay. Osmotic diarrhea, once feeds are stopped, so quantity of the stool also comes down. Discontinuation of feed results in improvement. Whereas secreted diarrhea doesn't pass. It continues. Even if they stop giving feeds, quantity is same. And announcement there, it is yesterday in, okay, so that causes perianal exfoliation. Acid stool, acid pH stools are there. So usually parents, they tie clothes, okay, they don't remove it, they don't clean after passing stool. So the acid stools are always touch with the skin, so that can cause excoriation of the abdominal distension before passing stool, seen usually in lactose intolerance. So these are the, if these signs are there, probably it is possible. Okay. Invisible areas, mucus and mucosal cells are invaded by enteropathogens. Because it is invasive. Okay, so microbes, they invade the intestinal mucosa. Okay, causing inflammatory reaction. Okay, so then there is inflammation, there is damage to the epithelium, so there will be bleeding into the stool, into the intestines, lumen, and mucus is also seen along with the stools. Blood and mucus along with stool is there, then it is invasified. Group is prone to develop complications like intestinal perforation, toxic megacolon, rectal prolapse, okay, and septicemia, okay, hemolytic uremic syndrome. The common example for it is enteroinvasive E. coli. Enteroinvasive E. coli. There are five types of E. coli that there, no? Among them, enteroinvasive is more. Okay. So what happens in acute diarrhea? Diarrhea losses are drawn from extracellular compartment, which constitutes circulating blood, interstitial fluid, and antibody and body secretions. Okay. So in diarrhea, what happens? Diarrhea losses are drawn from extracellular compartment. Okay. Normally, extracellular fluid turnover is 3 to 4 times greater than adults and children. So, loss of fluid in diarrhea stools causes early and significant dehydration in children. So, most extracellular fluid is lost. Extracellular fluid is maintained, but the fluid is drawn from the extracellular fluid, extracellular compartment. Fluid is lost in the intestines as diarrhea. So there will be loss of extracellular fluid. Okay. Proportionate loss of sodium result in isotonic dehydration. Proportional loss of sodium and water is isotonic dehydration, and 80% of the dehydration is isotonic. 15% are hypotonic dehydration. That means here the sodium water is loss is less and more. Sodium is lost more, so body sodium levels go down. That is called as hyponatremia. Okay, so if body sodium is sodium loss is more than the water, okay, more loss of sodium than water, it is called as hyponatremia. Leads to hyponatremic dehydration. 15% of dehydration set hyponatremia. The most common is isonatremia. Here, alkalis and water is lost. Equally, water loss is more than electrolyte, then it is hypertonic dehydration. If water loss is less than electrolyte, then it is hypotonic. So, the clinical features of diarrhea. If a patient is brought to the hospital, what are the questions you should ask? How do you come to a conclusion that it is the area? So for that we have to ask the history and we have to examine the child. So in the history, you have to inquire about the stool. How many times child is passing stool? Okay. What is the volume of the stool? What is the color of the stool? What is the characteristics of the stool? Okay. Only diarrhea is there or vomitings are also there. Then how about urine output? Urine output is the case and child is in dehydration. Okay. Then inquire about vomitings, especially vomitings, abdominal pain. Okay. Abdominal distension. If abdominal distension is there, probably he is having hypokalemia. Okay. Then sensorium. Fever, associated with fever. Probably any viral infection also can cause fever as well as diarrhea. Or respiratory tract infection, that's parental diarrhea can cause fever. Then 3 years feeding pattern. How was the, what was the feeding before becoming sick? How many bottles they are feeding top feed, they are giving top feeds, how they were giving feed. Okay. Then immunization history you have to take. In the immunization history, will the child receive rotavirus vaccine or not? Other systemic infections. Then any icterus, failure, clubbing, fetal edema is there. And look for signs of dehydration. Grade it as mild, moderate, or severe. Now dehydration is now graded as no dehydration, some dehydration, severe dehydration. Previously it was called as mild, moderate, severe. Now it is no dehydration, some dehydration, severe dehydration. Then we have to auscultate the any bowel sounds are there or absent. Bowel sounds are absent, probably it is hypokalemia. Hypokalemia is one of the complications of the okay. Tenderness. Tenderness is there, bowel sounds are absent, or increased bowel sounds, tenderness is there, probably there is perforation. In the general medullary bacteria, then any organomegaly is there. And diarrhea again, there is small intestinal diarrhea, large intestinal diarrhea. In case we can conclude whether it is small problem in the small intestine. If it is small intestine, large volume stools, watery stools, associated with vomiting, watery, large volume stools, that is probably pathology in the small intestines. Cramping, lower abdomen pain during defecation is not commonly seen in small intestine. It's commonly seen in large intestine. The positive organism do not ignore the mucosa here. Okay, it is non-invasive. They do not then massive loss of fluid results in hyperemia. Large intestinal areas, tiles, volume is small and it is blood and metal. Usually they have pain abdomen, lower abdomen. Dehydration is not commonly seen in large intestinal areas. Small intestinal area, volume loss is because so they don't dehydrate. Yeah? It's not that much loss, so they don't go into it. Usually they don't go into it. Okay. So, physiological agent reaches the mucosal barrier. So, breaking of infection. Now, infection is the commonest cause of diarrhea. Then, not only the dehydration, severe infection. It was mild, now, dehydration, they will have this kind of eyes are very sunken and dry, no eye appear, no eyes are so these are the features of severe dehydration. So dehydration is there, then you have to classified according to the weight loss also. The age of the child is less than 3 years, weight loss is 5%, it is mild dehydration. The weight loss is 5 to 10%, it is moderate dehydration. More than 10% it is severe dehydration in a child less than 3 years. Okay, in a child more than 3 years, weight loss is up to 3, it is mild dehydration and no dehydration. 3 to 6% it is some dehydration and moderate dehydration, more than 9% it is. Okay, so dehydration can be assessed according to weight loss also, clinically and weight loss. Okay. Sometimes they may have problem with the dehydration and the blood imbalance and the they may present as acidosis for the bicarbonate losses. Okay, so the child is brought to the hospital with diarrhea and having deep and increased breathing. This weight and deep breathing probably is not only having dehydration because of diarrhea, is also associated with the complication of diarrhea. Hypokalemia is another complication. Here they may present with abdominal distension, athletic ileus, okay, hypertonia, hyperreflexia, then ECG changes, then hypomagnesemia, okay, they come with diarrhea, dehydration, muscular twitching, and problems. Yellow blood losses in cholera, sodium and chlorides are lost more than other organisms. So, cholera, sodium loss and chloride loss are more in cholera. That is the reason why original ORS, which was the, okay, that contains more sodium and chloride more than recent ORS. Rotavirus diarrhea, sodium is loss of 37 nutrients per liter and chloride loss is 20 nutrients per liter. Okay. What are the complications of diarrhea? Complications are dehydration. Common is dehydration. Okay. If it's not treated, then you're going to acute renal failure. Okay. Most are lost, fluid is lost from the extracellular compartment. That is circulation, okay, there may be venous thrombosis. That becomes thick, there may be venous thrombosis in the brain or in the kidneys can cause. Okay. Then hemolytic uremic syndrome, malabsorption, food intolerance, intussusception. Okay, herniation of intestines into intestine, that is intussusception. Then disseminated intravascular coagulation, then persistent diarrhea, of electrolyte losses along with water recirculating, and if it is not treated properly, just like that, then we are going to malnutrition also. So, the child is brought to the hospital, admitted, so we have to investigate. So, these are the investigations we have to do in severe diarrheas. In severe, only we admit only severe diarrheas. Okay. In severe diarrheas, after admission, we have to do these investigations. School examination, we have to send. School culture sensitivity, also we have to send. Blood tests like CBP, okay, serum electrolytes, blood urea, creatinine. Then, to rule out sepsis, we have to do blood culture also. Then, to rule out any urinary tract infections, we have to do urine routine and microscope examination and culture. Then, septic screening. So, how to manage it? Once it is confirmed as diarrhea, for dehydration and other complications. So management is to prevent dehydration. It is having only mild dehydration or no dehydration, we should not go into moderate dehydration or severe dehydration. So we have to prevent that. Then treat the dehydration, nutrition support, and recovery. Okay. National Diarrheal Disease Control Program. Okay, this is one of the control programs for diarrhea in India. Okay, this we have to follow. Okay, so we have to manage the dehydration. Okay, we have to manage the dehydration, whether it is moderate or severe or mild, no dehydration or some dehydration, severe dehydration. We have to manage it accordingly. Take care of electrolytes also. Okay. So we have to assess the severity of the dehydration. So depending upon the severity, treatment changes. And if child needs oral fluid therapy or not, if child needs any IV, then we have to admit. Okay. So no dehydration, we have to follow plan A. If some dehydration is there, signs of some dehydration are there, we have to follow plan B. Severe dehydration, we have to follow plan C. So what is plan A, plan B and plan C? Where do you use this? Plan A is to treat diarrhea at home. That means there is no signs of dehydration. Okay. There is no dehydration or mild dehydration is there, which can be managed at home. Plan B, we have to keep them in the hospital. Keep them in the hospital. If there is no need to admit them, then in the OP we can manage it. Plan C, severe dehydration, so we have to admit. We have to admit and we have to start IV tubes for plan C. Okay. So, how can we manage it? Oral rehydration therapy. ORP is oral rehydration therapy. There is no need to admit it. So, how to manage it? Okay. Home fluids with substrate and sugar and salt solution. Okay. Or food based solutions like rice water, kanji, salt, lassi with salt can be given at home. Okay. Then glucose breakers, okay, glucose and salt water, plain water, lemon water, coconut water, soups, rice ganji, dal water, water without salt. All these are oral dehydration therapies which are prepared at home. So we have to tell the mother how to make all these things. Okay? Or they can make ORS at home also. How to make ORS, homemade ORS, in 1 liter water, boiled water, we have to add 1 spoon of salt and 4 spoons of sugar. That can be given. If ORS packets are available, medical store is there, they are containing ORS packets, that can be given. If not there, mother can prepare ORS at home by following this. What is not ORT, oral dehydration therapy? Only glucose water is given without salt. It is not ideal. Fruits without starch or sugar and salt, children who are starved. These should not be used. Okay. ORS, standard ORS, WHO ORS, was first made 100 years back because of the cholera outbreak. Cholera, sodium and chloride loss are more. So, sodium and chlorides are more in standard ORS. Reduced ORS, now we are using reduced osmolar ORS. Sodium is less, chlorides are less compared to standard ORS. Okay. Potassium is 20. Then standard ORS, total 311 milligrams are there. Reduced ORS, 230. Limitations of standard ORS, they do not decrease stool volume frequency. Potential risk of hypernatremia because they contain a lot of sodium, 111 11 milliequivalents of sodium is there in standard, 90 milliequivalents of sodium is there in standard ORS. So, children may say, hypernatric. So, that is why only in cholera cases we can use it. Because in cholera, sodium and chloride losses are more, which is ideal. Standard ORS is ideal for cholera. Reduced osmolar ORS, which we are using now, yes, the advantage is 39% reduction in IV fluids, 19% reduction in stool volume, 59% reduction in volume. So, best thing is to give reduced osmolar ORS. Okay. Now, improved ORS is also there. Apart from sugar and so on, these things are added. Rice base, amino acids, all productions. So, dehydration, acute diarrhea, it is there, diagnosed as acute diarrhea, but dehydration, if there is no dehydration, you have to follow plan A. What is plan A? It is risk of dehydration. Okay. The age of the child is less than 6 months, water is more than 4 times a day, liquid motion more than 8 times per day, the child is at high risk. So, we have to keep them in the hospital and observe. Okay, if the age is more than 6 months, volume of the stool, vomiting is less than 4 times a day and stool volume is stool number more than 8 times a day, then it is low risk. So it can be handled more. Okay, encourage to take more and discharge. So once you come to a conclusion that it is diarrhea with no dehydration, okay. Then, see, look for risk factors. High risk factors are there, don't send them home. Keep them in the OP and manage it. Low risk factors are there, you can advise the mother how to feed the child. Okay. Then, you can send them. Okay. So, oral dehydration therapy to prevent dehydration in plan A, counsel the mother 4 rules of home treatment. Tell the mother to give extra fluids as much as the child takes. Then they have to give zinc also. Say less than 2 months of fluid, or less than 2 months, there is no need to give zinc. 2 months to 6 months, 10 milligrams per day for 14 days. More than 6 months. Okay, more than 6 months, sorry. 6 to 20 milligrams per day. Okay. Then, tell the mother to continue feeding, okay, and when to bring back the child here, okay. Give extra fluid, because we have to give protein feeds and extra losses are there, so we have to give extra fluid as much as the child takes. Tell the mother to breastfeed, mother she need not stop feeding, okay, and along with breastfeeds, ORS has to be given. Food based fluids should be given, like rice water, banji, yogurt drink, okay, soup. Teach mother how to mix and give ORS. How to mix and give ORS we have to. Because ORS may not, packets may not be, the ready-made packets may not be available there at home. So mother has to prepare ORS. Then show how much extra fluid to give in addition to usual fluid intake. Okay. After 2 years, 50 to 100 ml after each loose stool. But from routine feeding intake, these are only for 2 glasses. After 2 years, 50 to 100 ml after each loose stool. 2 to 10 years, 100 to 200 ml, that is half glass to 1 glass. 1 glass is 200 ml. So tell the mother, if she tell 100 to 200 ml, mother doesn't know what to do. So tell the mother to give half to 1 glass of water, ORS, the age is 2 to 10 years. The age is more than 10 years, 1 glass or more than that, after each loose stool. So whatever is lost in the urine, in the stool, we are replacing it. So child doesn't go into dehydration. So this is to prevent dehydration. Okay? Then zinc. 2 months, less than 2 months, there is no need to give zinc. 2 months to 6 months, 10 milligrams per day for 14 days. 6 months and above, 20 milligrams per day for 14 days.
Once you start zinc, they need not stop. They have to continue for 14 days. Even if the child becomes normal, they have to stop. And show mother how to give zinc supplements. Okay. Remind mother to give zinc for fully 14 days. Okay. Apart from ORS, zinc has to be given. Then tell the mother to continue feeds routinely whatever she was given before becoming sick. In less than 6 months, breastfeeds are enough. More than 6 months, along with breastfeeds, they do weaning foods also. That has to be done. And the baby is not normal. Okay. Then they have to bring the child then to immediately when child is not able to drink or breastfeed. Child becomes sick. Blood notice tends to drinking poorly, even after 5 days, problem is continuing, then we have to bring back the child. Okay. So this is plan A. Plan A means there is there, but no dehydration. Okay. So even dehydration, we have to do fluids which are lost in the stools. Less than 2 years, half glass to 1/4 glass to half glass. 2 to 10 years, half glass to one, half to 1 full glass. More than 10 years, 1 full glass after each loose food. Plan B, suffer some dehydration. Okay. Here we have to correct the dehydration. Okay. So dehydration therapy to correct deficit. Need not admit it, but you have to keep in the ward. Give 75 ml per kg of ORS in 4 hours. Okay, in 4 hours, 75 ml per kg ORS is given orally. Then, maintenance therapy given, give 10 to 20 ml per kg ORS for each liquid stool. Okay. Provision of normal daily food requirement, rest meal should be given. Okay, even during dehydration. Is for severe dehydration. Severe dehydration we have to follow. This here we have to give IV fluids. The best IV fluid is sodium chloride or Ringerla. Okay. So what is the difference between sodium chloride and Ringerla? Normal saline is sodium chloride. Normal saline is 0.9% normal saline is usually used. Correct dehydration, which contains 154 mg sodium and 154 chloride. Whereas Ringer lactate, sodium quantity is less, chlorine quantity is less, but potassium is there in Ringer lactate. Okay, so the best thing is use Ringer lactate or 5% dextrose should not be used to correct the dehydration. Best IV fluid is Ringer lactate or cement. So, how much time we have to correct the dehydration? The age is less than 12 months. Okay? The age is less than 1 year. You have to take 6 hours to correct the dehydration. The age is between 2 to 5 years. Dehydration can be corrected within 3 hours. Okay. So, less than 1 hour, 1 year. 6 hours we have to take cut to correct dehydration. First hour, 30 ml per kg IV fluids are given as a Ringer lactate and normal saline. Next 5 hours, 70 ml per kg. The remaining 70 ml has to be given in each 5 hours. The age is between 1 to 5 years. Dehydration has to be corrected within 3 hours. Okay, 30 ml per kg in first 30 minutes, then 70 ml per kg in next 2.5 hours. Dehydration has to be corrected vigorously, fastly in children between 1 to 5 years. Less than 5 years, you can take up to 6 hours. The child is in shock, we have to give bolus. We have to create shock, for that we have to give bolus IV fluids. 20 ml per kg over 20 minutes. Okay? Then give another bolus. Look for signs of shock. Child has recovered, then switch over to the treatment C. Okay. During treatment, we have to monitor the child. We have to look at all these things. Okay, how is the child? For the vital signs, how is blood pressure? How is pulse? Okay, so normal pulse or weak pulse are not at all possible. Blood pressure normal, or less, or not recordable. Okay, depending upon that, we can come to a conclusion whether it is mild, moderate, or severe. Then intake and output. Okay, then physical examination. We have to evaluate child every day. Then clinical signs of nutrition or overload is there. Then we have to do electrical examination every 12 hours. Okay, these are not needed for me. Non-nurse children. Okay, my child is what? To the hospital and child is severely malnourished. Okay. The child is mild to moderate dehydration, we have to use Rizomal. Okay. What is Rizomal? Rehydration solution for malnourished. RE, V is for dehydration, SO for solution, ML for malnourished. So dehydration solution for malnourished is Rizomal. Okay. This 70 to 100 ml per kg of Rizomal is given over 12 hours, mild to moderate. There is no need to give IV feeds. Okay. Here, dehydration has to be corrected slowly. Usually, normally we correct it according to the age. We correct it. The age is less than 1 year, we correct dehydration in 6 hours. Okay. Ages between 1 to 5 years, we correct them. Dehydration is 3 hours now. But here in malnourished children, we have to take 12 hours to correct them. Okay. So this is Rizomal. Rizomal, sodium is only 45. Low osmolar is less. Okay. It is less than low osmolar. Food type in one child with diarrhea, severe dehydration, first 2 hours, 30 ml per kg, finger lactate, next 10 hours, 100 ml per kg, finger lactate. See, here we are taking 12 hours to correct the dehydration. So if child is not malnourished, less than 1 year, we take 6 hours, more than 1 year, 1 to 5 years, we take only 3 hours to correct dehydration. If child is malnourished and dehydrated, we have to take more time. 12 hours we have to take correct dehydration. Next 12 hours, remove 60 ml per kg of finger like that. Dehydration is corrected, maintenance should start with normal. Okay. 5% ratio is rate of 100 mg per kg. Potassium also has to be given. Okay, sometimes ORS is not going to help. We have to depend on IV fluids. So what are those conditions? When ORS is ineffective, high stool patch. High stool patch. Well, is passing 20 times, 30 times stools. Large quantities. And but child doesn't take that much fluid orally. So fluid loss is more than intake. When you're going to shock, renal failure. Prevent that, we have to use IV fluids. So ORS is not effective in that condition. High stool patch. More than 3 vomitings per hour. However, child is vomiting more than 3 times, what is the use of giving ORS? Whatever you give, they throw it out. Nothing is going to stay in the stomach and that thing is absorbed from the intestines. So what is the use? Child is in shock. Okay. They usually they don't respond to ORS. Unconscious child. They cannot swallow. If you put something in the mouth of an unconscious child, it may enter into the lungs. Respiratory problems. The child throwing a seizure. So they cannot take oral anything. So we have to depend on IV fluids. Abdominal distension because of paralytic ileus. The intestines are not working at all. So we have to start IV fluids. And glucose intolerance. that ORS contains glucose. If you give ORS to a glucose intolerant child, the diarrhea increases. Fluid volume increases. Okay. So in these conditions, we should not depend on ORS. And we have to monitor the child, okay, regularly. Okay. And feeding advice during diarrhea, during rehydration phase, breastfed infant, continue breastfeeds, non-breastfed infants. Okay, the mother can give animal milk if you offer if rehydration takes longer. Severe in malnourished children, offer some food as soon as possible. After rehydration, breastfed infants, the breastfeed should be continued more frequently. Non-breastfed infants, other undiluted milk with growth. Okay. Infants 4 to 6 months of age, give energy rich mixture of soft greeny foods in addition to breast or animal. Older children, okay, all other foods can be given. Okay, vegetables like bananas, legumes. Dark green vegetables, red palm oil, carrot, then if it is bacterial, we have to do antibiotics. Commonly it's viral only, but if it is bacterial, okay, then we have to do antibiotics, otherwise it doesn't suffice. So indications for chemotherapy are antibiotic self-limiting infection and unnecessary in most cases. Antibiotics are indicated in infants under 2 months of age because diarrhea can cause sepsis and so on. Okay. To prevent child going into sepsis, we have to do antibiotics. If child is brought to the hospital and the age is less than 2 months, coming to the hospital, diarrhea probably it is sepsis. So we have to treat it seriously. We have to do antibiotics. Cholera, again, we have to give antibiotics. Typhoid fever can present as diarrhea. Recently, yes, we have parental diarrhea like ear infection, tongue infection, urinary tract infection. We have to give appropriate antibiotics after getting culture sensitive. Then immunocompromised infants, severely malnourished. So what are the antibiotics? If it is Shigella, then the choice is Nalidix acid or proton. If it is enteroinvasive E. coli, Nalidix acid or proton or mucin pentamicin. Okay. Salmonella, typhoid, ampicillin or proton calicopropyl choice. Campylobacter jejuni, erythromycin or purigordin or proton pentamicin. Cholera, purigordin or proton pentamicin. Entamoeba histolytica, metronidazole, artemidazole, acetinidazole. Giardiasis, metronidazole, artemidazole, acetinidazole. Okay. Zinc, you know, less than 2 months we should not prescribe zinc. 2 months to 6 months, zinc has to be given 10 mg per day, 10 mg per day for 14 days. More than 6 months, 20 mg per day for 14 days. More than 6 months, whatever it is, even 8 years or 7 years or 5 years, whatever it is, 20 mg every day has to be given for 14 days. Pre and probiotics, yes, we have to discuss along with drugs, antibiotics, okay, ORS, then zinc, discuss probiotic also. Probiotics are non-pathogenic microorganisms, lactobacillus. Beneficial effect in rotavirus diarrhea, it reduces the duration of diarrhea in most cases. So along with ORS, zinc, we have to discuss probiotics. Okay. Anti-diarrheals we should not prescribe in children. Anti-diarrheals are prescribed in adults, okay, but not in children. Okay. Anti-diarrheals are contraindicated in infants and children because they are stool binders. Problem testing we should not. Because anti-motility drugs like loperamide we should not avoid in children. Okay, any cephalinase inhibitors like resicodactyl, we should not avoid it. Okay. So management of feeding during acute diarrhea, breastfed infants, tell the mother to continue breastfeeding. Okay, poor rehydration and maintenance phase. Formula fed, restart feed at full strength as soon as rehydration is completed. after 4 hours. Vein chill means normal food and solids following rehydration. Prognosis: mortality is high in newborns and infants. Mortality is high in newborns and infants. Probably it is a sepsis. If you don't give use antibiotic, appropriate antibiotic, then you can die. Malnutrition carries good prognosis. Systemic diarrhea, diarrhea with resistant immunity pathogens increases. So we have to send stool for culture to the examination, stool for culture. To use appropriate antibiotics. Severe dehydration with shock and dyslipidemia have adverse effect. Prompt and adequate therapy helps in prevention. How to prevent? Improvement of nutrition status. Safe drinking water supply in the community. Okay. And exclusive breastfeeding till 6 months. So they don't get infected. Thus, from breast, milk enters directly into the mouth of the child. No contamination. Okay. Easy availability of ORS sachets. ORS is now everywhere, it is available, but not costly also. And hand washing before and in the food. Mother has to wash her hands. The child is 4 years or 4 years. Mother has to wash child's hands also before feeding. Then vaccines, rotavirus vaccine is already available in the market now. ETC is not there, cholera vaccine is there, typhoid vaccine is there, shigella vaccine is there. Okay, so these are vaccines which are, rotavirus is available, cholera vaccine, typhoid vaccine is available. Okay, in India. Okay, other vaccines are not, still not available. So this is how we have to diagnose. Okay. We have to complete conclusion regarding the dehydration. We have to complete conclusion regarding the therapy. Then, how to prevent the infection. Okay, and how to continue feeds. Okay, so this is about diarrhea. This is the commonest problem in children. Second common problem for which they bring a child to the hospital. Okay? Hello.